Good evening and welcome back to our virtual Dominion Energy Jazz Cafe. Tonight, welcoming back the half of some familiar faces. Enjoy Modern Totem. Thank you. modern totem, ladies and gentlemen. Forrest, it's been a difficult week for me. But suddenly I feel quiet. And I thank you for that. The melody, just the general overall feel of the music tonight is what I needed. And I know someone at home needs it too. It's time for a break for your friends here. Would you join me for a conversation? Over here. Well, Forrest, thank you so much for that first set of music. I mean it when I say it's genuinely moving me tonight.
Oh, good.
We appreciate that.
Good.
At least I do. Before we get into our conversation, would you take a moment to tell the folks at home something about yourself in your own words?
Sure. Well, I draw and I drum. So I don't know which one takes priority with me. So I've had, you know, the struggle my whole life trying to figure out, well, should I just do this or should I just do that? So I just do both. Mm-hmm. You really just have to change, two letters between draw and drum. So that makes it easy. So I went to school for jazz. But I wound up only minoring in it because after 2 years I switched to illustration. And I love to play the drums. I have that drum set over there set up in my house. When I married my wife Holly, it was the first time in my adult life that I actually had a place I could practice the drums. Mm. You know, I would always have to rent a place. And but that same room, I have a big drawing table that I found at an antique store, and I do my lyric portraits over there, which are the drawings that are made out of either the lyrics to songs or poetry or the words from a book, quotes from a documentary film, any stuff like that, you know. And yeah, so I like to draw and drum.
I learned about those portraits the last time you were here, and they are impressive.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I have to say, for sure. Definitely check those out. Yeah. I don't know how I couldn't have done that. I don't know how you did it or where you got the inspiration for it.
Oh, my God. Well, I tend to be, my wife coined a term, you know, a lot of times you would call me like, you know, OCD, but she says persnickety.
Okay.
So that takes a persnickety personality to sit there and draw all those words. But
yeah. It's intricate and time consuming, I would imagine.
It is. And truth be told, I prefer just that what's more similar to the jazz is just sitting down and sketching and freehanding, mm-hmm. like if I were to sit here and just draw you, mm-hmm. you know, from life. That was when I was at VCU, that was my favorite thing to do.
We are going to get back into the music because I haven't asked you the second question I ask everybody. But before we do, tell the folks at home about these shoes you have on.
Oh, my God.
Something else.
These just came in the mail today from eBay. My wife and I, we also love to shop at Shop Goodwill, mm-hmm. which if anybody at home doesn't know about it, it's not goodwill.com, it's Shop Goodwill, and it's like eBay, only it's every Goodwill store in the entire country on one website selling things that are too nice to sell in the store.
Wow.
And so I have found some New Balance shoes on there. I've also found Ray-Ban sunglasses. I've found rare comic books, rare snare drums.
Wow.
And you could look up anything, say look up, cowboy boots, and there could be like 80 pages of results for cowboy boots. I only say that because I actually play in a country band sometimes and I have to wear cowboy boots. But these came in the mail today, and I saw a really cool young guy at Diversity Thrift last week wearing these shoes, and I had to ask him about them because these are like the holy grail of New Balance. Mm. Like, what I like about New Balance is the really colorful designs, and sometimes you find some that you'll get like two or three really cool colors, usually just two, and I've got a few of those, but this, when I saw his, I was like, oh my God, that's it, you know. So they came in the mail today just completely coincidentally with today, so.
Sometimes that's how you find rare gems, somebody else wearing them.
Yeah, so these were used as well, yeah. I rarely buy new shoes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, everybody at home, shopebay.com. Not a sponsor, but I'm going to be checking them out.
Shop Goodwill,
I said the wrong thing.
That's okay.
That's why they're not a sponsor.
eBay's good too, obviously.
Okay, so years back, before you became a jazz minor in school, what was the first experience that got you interested in taking up the craft?
Well, my cousin Carla had a boyfriend named Teddy who had a drum set. He had this big black Yamaha drum set with toms just everywhere pointing at you, and it was just the coolest looking thing. At the time, I was in middle school and I was listening to Led Zeppelin and Rush and, you know, a lot of different, you know, kind of heavier stuff. And he let me play them and I was hooked. I had some friends that were musicians and I didn't actually play anything at the time, but they wanted to be in the talent show, the eighth grade talent show at Robius Middle School. So they asked me if I would play drums and they wanted to do Stairway to Heaven and Rock and Roll, and I think they did one other tune, but I can't remember what it was, but that was it. I practiced on his kit, and then eventually I saved up my money from a couple of paper routes and bought my own kit. Another black kit, but this was a Max Win by Pearl kit that I got off the trading post.
Wow.
The paper book, yeah. Long before Craigslist, you know. And we drove up, my mom drove me out to Chester, Virginia, and I looked at it and it was great because it came with two extra little toms, just like Neil Peart almost, not quite as big, but so I could do the whole thing. So that was it, yeah.
That's impressive, and I think everyone as a kid, as they're getting into music, thinks drums are cool. I've played for a while myself.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I gave it up because you have to carry them in everywhere you go.
Oh, yeah. That's the...
Well, as a singer, I just sort of show up and they tell me what to sing and then I do it.
Right, right. I would love to be more portable like that. That's the dream. But that cart you had tonight, that was great. So thank you for that.
Anytime you come, you're welcome to it. Your experience as a composer.
Okay. So that's something I don't get to talk about very often. And aside from drumming and drawing, I love to play the piano. And I'm not a performing pianist. I've never been in a band as a piano or keyboard player, but I've always had a keyboard. I love composing. I love sitting. It's therapeutic to me to just sit often into the wee hours of the morning before I go to bed and just composing little things. And I have piles and piles of old cassette tapes and also digital recordings. And I'm currently working on finally trying to get some of those ideas into an album. I've had a couple of tunes that were recorded. The last band I was in, the Dank Tet, which had Brian Mesko on guitar, Dane Alderson on bass, who plays with the Yellow Jackets, and Jonah Kane West on keyboards. There's the title track of that album, One Thing Right, was just this little thing I was doing on guitar back in 96, and I'd really the only thing I could play, you know, I just for a while, and I just my Brian heard me play it one time, asked me to show him how, and like a couple of months later he was jamming at his house with Dane on bass, just him as a duet, and he asked me if he could write a B section to it. Oh. And I was like, sure, I'd be honored, man. So it turned into a song. We decided we wanted to record it, and then the rest of the album came out of that. Mm. And so there's like four of my original tunes on there. But because of the pandemic, I'm thinking about, you know, doing all of the stuff myself, basically, you know, at home right now with the newer tunes. So I'll keep you posted.
I like to compose myself. I compose from the vantage point of a singer and of a conductor. As a drummer, how are you trying to tell your stories, and how do you craft a melody line?
Well, you know, there probably is a little bit of the drummer in me when I play the piano, because I kind of come up with a rhythmic pattern, you know, that might have a... It usually has two things going on, and a lot of times they're polyrhythmic, but the melody winds up being part of the nature of that pattern,
right.
And I can improvise that melody a little bit. So I guess to answer your question, like the drumming comes in more as like making me play rhythmically, A lot of times I'm not doing just like a chord and then a chord and then a chord kind of thing. I play like a drummer on the piano.
I think I do too. I like to tell people I'm not a pianist, but I understand how music works. I understand how the piano works, and I understand how rhythm works.
Yeah.
So you're really just being fooled by the sounds I'm making, rhythmically and melodically and harmonically.
Well, and I tell you, there's a lot of drummers that almost every drummer I know also plays keyboards. Mm-hmm. And there's a really famous guy that I shouldn't say really famous, but he is. He's kind of, you've heard him, even if you didn't know you heard him. So first of all, he's a fusion jazz drummer, Gary Husband, but he played with Alan Holdsworth. Alan was, you know, part of Tony Williams' band, which is, you know, like Six Degrees of Seven Bacon's, Miles Davis and everything. But Gary Husband is also an amazing piano player, and he's toured with Billy Cobham on piano. But Gary was also the drummer for Level 42 in the 80s.
Yeah.
So there's all kinds of crazy, I could tell you all kinds of crazy stories about drummers that also play the piano. It's fascinating.
Versatility is a key element of success in this business. You gotta have that.
And it helps you appreciate what the other musicians are doing too, if you play another instrument.
And to me, it helps me to, I don't know, guess or feel what might be coming next, what they might do, what I might be able to augment from my end.
Exactly. Yeah.
You brought several different kinds of ways of playing these drums tonight.
Oh, right.
I'm sure people ask all the time about the difference between a stick or a mallet or a brush, and why would you choose to use one over the other? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. I was mentioning to you earlier as an aside that and it's not just John Cage, but John Cage comes to mind in the whole prepared piano thing, where he would put nuts and bolts and tinfoil and nails and stuff to make a piano sound really different, have a lot of different textures. And I've always thought, you know, you can do that kind of thing to drums as well. There's not only just in a practical sense when you're in the studio and you want your drums to be muffled to get that kind of like dry 70s, you know, groove sound, or if you want them to be more wide open, tuning them higher, but like actually adding, like tonight, I don't know if you noticed, but the muffles I had was just a piece of packing tape and part of a sock.
Wow.
That was just taped. And so what it does, it's like a natural noise gate. So when you hit, it comes up, but then it comes right back down. It lets enough sound out, but not too much ring. And then you might have seen me playing, I need to do a shout out to Proper Pie, because we love Proper Pie. It's my favorite place. In fact, I think my wife has some Proper Pie for me when I get home, because it was my birthday this week.
Happy birthday.
I turned 47 this week. And so I took one of those little tins, you know, washed it out real good, and I brought it tonight and just had some painter's tape on the edge of the snare, and it added another like a textural element, gave the drum a little bit of muffle, but also you know, kind of a higher pitch as well, which is, I think I used it on Big Chief, and it just, that tune is like Professor Longhair's, you know, it's kind of got a New Orleans vibe to it. So that anything that calls out a little bit more attention to the snare drum is good in that situation. And also I found, you know, just like, I have a collection of tambourines at home, and the one that I brought tonight is just this little child's plastic tambourine that's very lightweight, which is great. You just plop it on top of the hi-hat. So that, I like that one a lot, because it doesn't impede if I want to do a grab on the hi-hat, like it's really quick, or if I want to, it doesn't stop it from resonating because it's so lightweight. But when you go up and down with your foot, it gives a nice, you know, tambourine click, which is good. Stick-wise, you asked me about sticks, sorry. Yeah, Matt, anything really. You can use anything. I've got the standard like mallets, you know, little soft mallets and brushes, and And you know, like the sticks I was mainly using tonight were Peter Erskine ride sticks that have a smaller tip, which has a lot of articulation on the cymbal. Mm-hmm. But I'm a big fan of playing the drums with anything you find, your hands, but even found objects. I have a set, I didn't bring them, but I have a set of sticks that I made out of barbecue skewers.
Oh, wow.
And you just take those store-bought barbecue skewers, cut them to whatever length you want, get some duct tape, wrap in a couple of strategic areas, put a little walking stick rubber cap on the bottom of it, maybe stick some epoxy on there so it stays in place. And you've got these things that are very similar to a stick you can buy, but those sticks are usually like $35, $40. Mm-hmm. And I had maybe like $7 worth of supplies in what I made. So same effect. And you can, I highly recommend anybody experimenting. Sometimes people that, like my students, will get really even more excited because they made something that they're using to hit the drums with, and so they want to play something for me because it sounds so cool.
I bet that's a great experience for them.
Yeah,
not only learning how to play, but learning how to be innovators in their craft or in the way they think about their craft.
Yeah, I mean, because your instrument needs to be malleable. You need to feel like you have some control over that sound. And so it's like, you know, it feeds whatever you're wanting to do.
Forrest, I imagine in the front and back of my mind that somewhere in your home on a bookshelf, collecting dust, are three Emmys. What was that process like? And congratulations, first of all, but what was the work like earning such accolades?
Well, so I have to first say that I am just one of many people on a production team for some really great documentaries. Is VGO Productions hired Frank Coleman, a friend of mine, to compose the music. And then Frank brings us in, me, John Wynn, Daniel Clark, Randall Farr, all kinds of, you know, Jackie Frost, lots of musicians have come in and been part of these documentary soundtracks. And he gives us, you know, a very bare bones composition where he'll just play the melody and the guitar, melody on the guitar along with the chords, and give us an idea. And he'll record us playing it in literally every style. We'll do the same thing in bossa nova. We'll do a long form ballad. We'll do it as an up-tempo swing. We'll do it more rocking. And he just collects all of this great, you know, audio footage that, and just turns it into VGO Productions so that they can use it in places wherever they want throughout the documentaries. Mm-hmm. And we've had that working relationship for a long time with Frank and with VGO, and they've done several documentaries that we were on. One of them was called The Kennedy Half Century, which was, I believe, in conjunction with UVA's Center on Politics. Germany bought the rights to that documentary because it had so many presidential Germany speeches in it that it was like historically valuable to them. And that one won an Emmy. The first one I ever did with them, though, was the Sailor Bob story. And that was, Sailor Bob was like a Captain Kangaroo kind of guy that hosted a cartoon show here on public access television. Really super cool guy. He also drew pictures. Okay. He would teach kids how to draw pictures. And he hosted like the Popeye cartoon hour or whatever. Had this really elaborate set where you're on a ship and he had this puppet seagull that would, before the Muppet Show, this puppet seagull would come out of the, you know, the little glass window and talk to you, and really cool. I didn't know about him until we did this documentary and I was just fascinated. And it premiered at the Bird, and that was the first one, I think, that won an Emmy. And I'm trying to remember the other one. I think might have been one called Out of Order, which I can't remember if that was about the 1968 presidential campaign or not, but it was politically oriented also. So Yeah, I don't physically have those Emmys. I just am on the team, you know, the overall production crew that won the Emmy. And I think I could actually ask for one, like to send me one, but it's all right. I got too much on my bookshelf at home already.
Well, it's three more than I have, so you're doing better than me.
Well, thanks.
I say often, and I think I'll say every time, a great educator makes all the difference here. As a teacher yourself, what legacy do you hope you're leaving behind to your students or with your students?
You know, I hope that I'm passing on a lot of just word of mouth, wisdom, things that that become integrated into their way of looking at creativity and how they express their own inner voice and tell their own stories. I don't necessarily hope to get any accolades out of it. I just I kind of take my teaching, my lessons are a lot like playing a song, you know? Like, I take the student where they are that day. What's their mood, and what is it we can try to accomplish, you know, in that moment that best serves what really excites them about music, you know? I actually don't have a lot of students that are like working on auditions for a college music program or trying to get into, you know, like marching band and stuff like that. Right. Mostly it's, my students are kind of like I was when I was young, and I just played because I loved it, you know, and I was never in, you know, jazz band at school or any of the extracurricular things. But I played music with my friends in garage bands.
The love of the craft is precious on its own, I think. And perhaps that's what you're passing along to the generations of drummers coming behind you. And
yeah.
I would like to imagine they're grateful for it.
I hope that they just, you know, are able to get in touch with a love and a passion that sustains them, you know, and that they see it as something they can use therapeutically, you know.
I was just thinking that, yeah, keep themselves out of trouble banging on some drums.
Right, exactly.
There's a lot of that could go around. Well, Forrest, I've kept you longer than I promised, and you've got another set of music to perform. Are you ready for it?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. I could take a moment to introduce the band here. On bass, we've got Carter Blough. On saxophones, Alan Wittig. And on guitar, Chris Vasi. And together we are Modern Totem. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Played a lot of songs by some of our heroes like Todd Rundgren and Thelonious Monk, had some Duke Ellington, and then just some Professor Longhair there. We're going to end out with another Thelonious Monk tune called I Mean You.
Well, ain't that what they call jazz? He said maybe. They call it something. Modern Totem. Thank you for the music. Forrest, that's how you win an Emmy. Back there. BJ, Richmond Jazz Society. Like I said earlier, I had a rough week, and you brought me the fellas that brought a little eye to the storm of it. I'm going to try to live in this moment as long as I can. Thank you to the Richmond Jazz Society for providing us with the art and with the music. To Dominion Energy, we thank you for paying for programs like this one we're all enjoying right now. Of course, remember, Tommy Productions is behind these cameras. We thank you for that, and Chris is up in that booth giving us sound and lights. Those of you at home, thank you for loving with us. Thank you for listening to us. And thank you for learning from us. In Richmond, Virginia, from the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts on the Leslie Cheek Theater stage, this has been our virtual Dominion Energy Jazz Cafe. I'm Robert Fennard. Good night.